So what happens when big money enters medicine and can influence academic publications? Should healthcare become more of a business than a science? Should physicians and other healthcare leaders be investing in practices and healthcare businesses that pose a perceived significant conflict of interest? Is medicine the next boom for venture capitalists? Welcome to The Clinical Divide. I'm Dr. Kevin Campbell. I'm a Duke-trained cardiologist and the CEO of the health data startup Pacemate. Every week, this healthcare analytics news video series examines medicine and healthcare technology's top news. I try to bring you the views that help physicians and healthcare executives bridge the clinical divide. Let's talk about data suppression and private equity. Today's story brings us to the headlines in the New York Times and a report concerning the field of dermatology. Historically, the practice of dermatology is highly profitable. It's a great specialty with great hours, and the overhead involved in a dermatology practice is quite low. The specialty is interestingly seeing a wave of private equity firms swooping in and buying and running practices across the nation. This trend is fueling consolidation, and many think that's driving up costs. It's also causing some dermatologists to wonder whether a focus on profits are now beginning to outweigh the importance of providing high-quality patient care. Let's face it, most doctors focus on providing high-quality care, and the economics of running a busy practice have always been a secondary consideration. However, venture capitalists and private equity firms are now singularly focused on making money at all costs. Several researchers set out to examine how the influx of private equity is playing out in the dermatology space. They published an article in the Journal of the American Academy of Dermatology this month, and they found that investors are buying up practices that perform a large number of procedures that earn big bucks, big reimbursements from Medicare. They also found that these organizations are opening high-profit laboratories and recruiting very influential dermatologists to support their practices. All of this is designed to maximize profits and their own ROI. The peer review article ignited a firestorm, and in a little more than a week after it was published, the journal's editor scrubbed it from the website. They took it down. They suggested the article might be retracted and/or revised. After getting a lot of pushback from academics and those on his own editorial board, the editor of the JAAD eventually admitted that people associated with private equity firms involved in purchasing these dermatology practices had lodged complaints, questioning the accuracy of the facts that were presented in the paper. These private equity groups demanded that the article be removed. Interestingly, some of those that were involved in the private equity firm complaint included leaders of the American Academy of Dermatology, which publishes the very journal, which suggests a ton of conflict of interest. The paper's authors are vehemently denying any inaccuracies or biases, yet the paper is no longer available online. There's really a lot to unpack with this story here, so let's get to it. First, do we really want private equity firms running medical practices? These organizations, as they should be, are all about cutting costs and maximizing profits. As clinicians, we are sworn to advocate for patients, and we just cannot allow these things to happen at the expense of patient care. Perhaps our friends in the C-suite and other healthcare executives can talk to private equity folks and share best practices to support both top-notch medical care and the economic stability and health of a healthcare system. No matter what the case, administrators and doctors must talk openly about partnerships, investments, and expectations. In the end, it's all about the patients, right? But however, the bottom line in medicine is now, more than ever, dictating how doctors and patients interact. We cannot sacrifice care for more cash. We must limit conflict of interest in medicine, and we must make sure that we keep a close eye on the commercialization of medicine. It's getting away from us. Second, it's very concerning to me that a respected journal could pull a peer-reviewed article that took more than a year of research to complete and write without a detailed and immediate explanation. When journals are responsive to outside pressures from private equity firms, it smells a lot like the pharma lobby in Washington, D.C. This is completely unacceptable, in my opinion. Science and well-conducted research should be above the influence of big money interest groups. Unfortunately, this is no longer the case. At some point, we all must take medicine back and refocus on the patient. Data and science are critical to healthcare's growth and the advancement of medical science. Private money to fund studies is absolutely vital, but those private funds must remain outside of the laboratory and must accept whatever results and conclusions are drawn from a good study. Yes, we need to vet the information and conclusions of a study, and that's why we have peer-reviewed journals. But no, we can't pick and choose findings and pull findings out just because we don't like them. If we do, then how will we ever decide which study is reliable and worth changing our practice for? Now, maybe that's not what happened here, but it sure looks a lot like me to me like there's something rotten in the state of Denmark, to quote a little Shakespeare. At the very least, this is a reminder for physicians and C-suite executives alike. Even if you don't like what the data suggests, you've got to analyze the quality of the research and ultimately respect the conclusions of a well-designed study. That's the only way we can continue to advance science and improve our patients' lives. Again, thank you for joining me for this episode of The Clinical Divide. Until next week, I'm Dr. Kevin Campbell for Healthcare Analytics News.